Hi, I'm Toby and welcome to the Joy of Mathematics. I'm so glad you could join me today. I'm going to run some ideas across the bottom of the screen, and these are ideas which we will come to understand today. It's another beautiful day outside today, although it is a little windy. I've gone ahead and already drawn a tree for us, but a tree is a little bit like an iceberg in that what you can see on the surface is only a small part of the story. What is going to be really important to us today is what we can see underground. A tree could not exist without its roots. Now, last time I saw you, we were talking about logarithms and how they can be used to rewrite exponents. One particularly popular exponent is the square, a number times itself. We could have 3 times 3 is equal to 9. 4 times 4, which is 16, or even 5 times 5, which is 25. These are all squares and could be written as 3 squared, 4 squared, or 5 squared. But what if some leaves carried by the wind were to come across and land right here and right here? So that all we could see was the result. We knew that something squared was equal to 16, but we couldn't quite remember what. Well, what we would need to do would be to find the square root of 16. Roots are what allow a tree to grow. The better the roots, the more nutrients they can collect and the more support they can provide. Just like in life, having support can make it feel easier to achieve great things, although support can often be hard to come by or difficult to recognize. I'm just drawing in our roots here. You can see these roots would be very good at providing some moral and structural support to the tree. We also forgot to add the apple to our tree before, so we can go ahead and sneak that in now. Now, in these square roots, there are 16 units of dirt. That's the area of the square. An area of a square is calculated from its base times its height, and since these are the same, if we know the length of just one side, we know the square root. We can go ahead and divide this up into a grid, and if the length of each side was 3, then we would have 9 units of dirt. But if instead it was 5 on each side, we would have 25 units of dirt. But the sweet spot for us, and you're going to see it here, is that if each length of the roots, each side of the square, is 4 units long, then in total we will have 16 units of dirt sitting right here in our roots. And that's exactly what we wanted. So we know that the square root of 16 will be equal to 4. All these numbers that I've mentioned, 9, 16, 25, they're all called perfect squares because they are the squares of whole numbers. We could look at a non-perfect square, say 20, although all numbers are perfect in their own way. And we could look, well, 20 is between 16 and 25, so the square root of 20 would be somewhere between 4 and 5. And in fact, it is 4.47. Now, there's actually another solution to all of these square roots, and I hate to mention it as an afterthought because nobody likes being an afterthought. But we could have also had, for example, minus 4 times minus 4 being equal to 16, because two wrongs make a right. But in our case, having a negative side length wouldn't make a lot of sense, so we were fine to just take the positive solution. There is actually a symbol that tells us to look underground and find the square root of a number, and that is this heartbeat kind of symbol here called the radical, because it is pretty radically cool. Now, I remember when I very first encountered this symbol on some math homework at school, but I was pretty confused because I'd never seen it before, I didn't know what it was called, and I didn't know how to find out. I wanted to Google it, but I didn't know how to describe it in the Google search. Do you type in tick-like symbol or heartbeat? I kind of liked the name heartbeat symbol. Now, if you're like me, you might be a little bit curious as to the root of this square root symbol, and there seems to be a little bit of disagreement about where exactly it comes from. One story that I've heard as to its origin is that it comes from the Arabic word for root, and it comes from the first letter of the word, which looks a little bit like this. The Latin word for root is actually radix, and it comes from radix quadratum, which actually means the side of a square. Some mathematicians wrote this as capital Rx. Now, that might have made its way to becoming the modern symbol, or it might have also come from a lowercase r, also for radix. But there's one more possible origin story, and that is that some mathematicians used to denote a square root as putting a dot or a few dots above the numbers that they wanted to take the square root of. And it's thought that maybe somewhere along the way these dots just acquired a bit of an upstroke and that became our symbol. What we do know is that in 1637, Descartes was the first to use the square root symbol with this line over the top. It has a name, it's called the vinculum, and that includes everybody in the square root who was supposed to be there. It's like a big group hug. The square root symbol typically means to just take the principal or the positive result of the square root. So there is only one leaf that would satisfy the square root of 16 is equal to leaf. Only one solution would satisfy that, but if instead we were to have leaf squared is equal to 16, there are two leaves that would satisfy this, and we would have to write our answer as being plus or minus 4. The square root can also just as easily be written as 16 to the half. We can start using fractional powers. And for other roots, say the cube root, we would just extend this to be 16 to the 1/3, or we could write 3 in our little square root symbol, and that would give us a different solution. Squaring any number, positive or negative, will give us a positive result. Squaring 0 will give us 0. So there is actually no way for a negative number to have any real root. But we can make things more inclusive if we invite over our imaginary friends. If we have, or we introduce our friend I, squared to be equal to minus 1, then we would have that I is equal to the square root of minus 1. Technically, minus I would also be equal to the square root of minus 1, but by convention, we just take positive I to be our square root minus 1, our principal root. Then, if we wanted to do the square root of minus 16, we could do that, and it would give us the square root of 16 times the square root of minus 1, leading us to an answer of 4i. Moral of the story is don't let anyone tell you that you can't have a square root. You can even take the square root of an imaginary number, but you can see my other video for how to do that. So that has been our trip underground to understand square roots. If you haven't already, then take a walk near some trees and try to imagine what their hidden roots look like. I'd like to wish you happy studying, and I hope that you have an absolutely mathematical day.